Hello, welcome to Breaking It All Down. I'm Count Zero. This week, I am taking a look at another video game, a platformer this time. I'm taking a look at Rayman Origins for the Xbox 360 and PlayStation 3. Specifically, I'm going to be focusing on the 360 version for my footage, but from a graphical standpoint and more or less control standpoint, they're approximately the same. If you aren't familiar with the Rayman series, Rayman is a figure with no limbs as far as arms and legs, but a head, a torso, and hands and feet. You go through each stage collecting lums and rescuing electoons. Yeah, the Rayman universe is kind of weird. If you played a 2D platformer before, then the way this game plays should be fairly familiar. You go from left to right, taking out enemies along the way, and picking up collectibles, in this case, the lums. You keep going till the end of the stage, where you rescue some caged electoons by defeating the enemies holding a field around them. Most levels will also have two hidden caged electoons you can rescue, and you can earn further electoons by collecting enough lums and by beating a level before the par time. Clearing enough levels will unlock treasure races, which in turn get you ruby teeth, which will unlock some bonus levels. Basically, with these stages, you have to keep pace with the treasure chest that's racing through the stages full speed. These stages are tough and will have you dying a lot. Each world also breaks things up with some side-scrolling shoot-'em-up segments where you fly a hummingbird thingy while shooting down enemies and generally just making your way through the stage. After completing enough of these little worlds, you get to go after the horribly distorted and deformed Glade Kings, who you have to defeat in order to return them back to their true forms. However, to get to them, you'll have to collect a certain number of electoons, so you'll need to backtrack to get some of the ones that you missed. Good lord, those things aren't nightmare fuel. Anyway, this game's controls are solid and responsive. This is good, because the game's treasure race sequences are very fast-paced, and you need that responsiveness if you're going to actually stand a chance of completing them. My only real complaint with the game is with the designs of the nymphs who give Rayman his powers. Well, I don't mind fan service particularly, and I don't consider myself a prude, but considering the game's rating of E10+, I think the characters could have been a bit less fan servicey. Just saying. Well, this is a solid platformer. The levels are well designed. They are perfect for both older and younger gamers. Younger gamers will be able to pick up the tricks for the level design and be able to basically become a better platformer player at this due to the nicely set up learning curve for this game, while older players who've been going through platformers basically since Mario and onwards should be able to get right in there and basically get the ball rolling and get through things more quickly, because they know what they're doing and they'll be able to get things done, well, better than the youngins. As it is, this game has little content that will offend parents, aside from possibly the aforementioned nymph stuff. So this is a solid recommendation across the board. Really, there's no good reason not to get this game. It is, well, honestly, one of the best platformers in quite some time to come on a console that isn't from Nintendo. I definitely think you should check it out. Well, that's done. I got a lot of time left. Let's talk about the Hugo Award nominees for Best Fancast. Now, this is the new award this year. It's going to be a one-year-only thing thus far, focusing on podcasts. If you don't know what a podcast is, that's odd. You go Google search for it, but if you're too lazy for that, if you're on this video and you don't want to pause it, a podcast basically is a show kind of like this, possibly audio only, where your show is online, you people can subscribe to it via an RSS feed, and it will be picked up through iTunes, any other podcast client thingy and go onto your iPod or your other third-party MP3 player or what have you, and you can watch it or listen to it at your own time. Ultimately, like a time-shifted radio show or TV show. Short version. For those of you who are surprisingly deprived of the internet. Anyway, on to the really important stuff. Like, what makes for a good podcast? And, in short, for me, a good podcast engages me in some way, shape, or form. If it's a roundtable discussion podcast, it makes me want to take part in the discussion in a good way. It makes me want to contribute. It makes me interested in what these people have to say. It makes me want to ask them more questions to get them to expand their viewpoints and expand on the arguments they make so I can learn more. It makes me wish I was there with a cup of coffee or adult beverage of choice and just enjoying the experience. Alternatively, if it's a sort of, for lack of a better term, a zine-type podcast where it has a bunch of separate segments, each with different people, it makes me look forward to particular segments or themes or that sort of thing. So, what makes a bad podcast? Well, aside from being boring, because ultimately, I mean, if you're boring me and you're a form of entertainment, you failed horribly, then what otherwise makes for a bad podcast is one where I want to kind of leap in with the clue bat, where people are saying things which are obviously, definitely, totally wrong, and I just go, no, no, this is bad, you're messing up. Not even you're messing up, you're telling falsehoods. Stop. At which point, I either, because I'm listening to podcasts in the car, I'm either, like, fast-forwarding or constantly reaching down to pause it so I can shout my frustrations futilely to the fellow drivers on the road who hopefully don't misinterpret what I'm saying as being some sort of criticism on their driving. And in those cases where podcasts are that frustratingly negative, or just frustratingly wrong, ultimately those are a deal breaker, and I unsubscribe to them. So with that in mind, the nominees for Best Fancast for the Hugo Awards are The Cood Street Podcast, hosted by Jonathan Strahan and Gary K. Wolf; The Galactic Suburbia Podcast, hosted by Alisa Krasnostein, Alex Pierce, Tansy Rayner Roberts, and produced by Andrew Finch. No relation, I presume, to the video game journalist Andrew Finch. The Sci-Fi Signal Podcast, or SF Signal Podcast. There's actually a Sci-Fi Signal and SF Signal, so we don't confuse those. The SF Signal Podcast, hosted by John DiNardo and J.P. Franz, and produced by Patrick Hester, I believe is tied in to the SF Signal e-zine, fanzine. SF Squeecast, hosted by Lynn M. Thomas, Sheenan McGuire, Paul Cornell, Elizabeth Baer, and Catherine M. Valenti. Also bears mentioning that Sheenan McGuire also has as her pen name, what's her face? I'll put the name in the subtitle. She's the one who writes all of the zombie apocalypse blogger novels, like Feed and Deadline. And finally, Tony C. Smith's Starship Sofa, which was previously nominated for Best Fanzine. Now, I've listened to all of these. This is the first case where I've consumed all of the works that have been nominated before coming to the episode, so I can actually make a decision about which one I would like to win. Though, because I have no money and can't thus register to vote for the Hugos, I can't actually vote for a winner. Sadness. But I can give the information on who I want. Honestly, of all of these, the only one I really disliked was the SF Signal podcast. Maybe it's because I came in a bad episode or what, I don't know, but it just, like, bugged me. they were discussing whether Mars is cursed at the box office, or particularly Mars in SF, in sci-fi. And this is they brought this on based off the failure of Mars Needs Moms and John Carter of Mars, and the fact that the Total Recall remake also omits Mars, though admittedly, I don't recall if Mars was in the original story. We can remember it for you wholesale, as much as it was added for the Paul Verhoeven version. And what happened was, the decision that the discussion went to was, it's not that Mars is cursed at the box office, it's that science fiction as a whole is cursed at the box office. Not like hard science fiction either, but any work of science fiction is cursed at the box office. And this made me go, what? Because, honestly, the biggest blockbusters in cinema are sci-fi. The highest grossing film in the history of film, not in the 20th century, not in the history of... actually, the highest grossing piece of entertainment possibly in the history of entertainment, if not just film in general, Avatar, is science fiction. People will go see movies that are science fiction. And not just geeks like me with my science fiction posters in the back of the room and my poster of Kamina from Gurren Lagann and my Star Trek remake poster on the door with all my Star Wars and Spider-Man stuff. No. It's not just geeks like me who will go see science fiction movies and pay money for it. Lots of people will go see science fiction movies and pay money for it, whether it's for spectacle, whether it's because they're looking for big ideas, or a combination thereof. And this isn't including, and since they brought this up, this includes superhero movies as well. People enjoy science fiction. They may not read science fiction books, maybe because of a degree of snootiness on their part, maybe because they're not willing to give it a chance, or maybe because, to a certain extent, possibly science fiction literature has gotten a little bit insular, and there is not necessarily as much science fiction that I would say, newer science fiction, which would work well for people wanting to get their feet wet. I don't know. I would say that the last one isn't necessarily the case, but some people may think of it that way. They may read something like a book I'm going to read in a review next episode, The Quantum Thief. They might look at that and try and read the concept and find it too abstract for them. I don't know. But ultimately, though, science fiction can do well in the box office, has done well at the box office, will do well in the future at the box office. And to say otherwise would be to kind of perpetuate a falsehood. And that, thus, when I read that, and I heard that on the Fancast, it just made me go... So, that's the only one where I really felt the Clubat compulsion in the episode. The rest of them were generally okay. The Cood Street podcast and Galactic Suburbia didn't really click with me. Cood Street, I don't know why. It just didn't quite mentally kind of connect. I don't know if it's just a case of the people on the show didn't quite fit with my sort of, with the energy I want in a podcast. I'll have to listen to a few more episodes to see, but I didn't get that instant click. Galactic Suburbia, it was okay. They have a very sort of kind of feminist take. Not feminist, that kind of very feminist take on science fiction fandom, and that's fine. There needs to be a place for that. It's just, well, as a panel show, and as I mentioned before, for a good panel podcast, it's a thing where I want to take part. And I feel like there'd be wait place for me to take part, and I didn't get that impression. Not that the hosts of the show, I think, are hostile towards men, as much as this is the feminist show, we're talking about things from the female perspective. If you're a guy, you have plenty of other opportunities to express yourself in your own way on these issues, and you can go take them. We have our place here, and we don't need you butting in and trying to take it from us. That's fine, but it does kind of... it felt somewhat off-putting. I don't know. So I didn't hate the podcast, it just, I didn't connect. So that kind of ruled out my vote for me. The other two, on the other hand, are a dead tie. First up is the Sci-Fi Squeecast, or SF Squeecast, which basically is a whole bunch of science fiction writers on a kind of rotating panel with one guest person every week sitting down and talking about books that they like. It is meant to be totally positive because these are all published and successful writers, some of whom have been nominated for Hugo's and other major awards before, and they're coming in to give their thoughts on all things, well, geeky, and in particular science fiction related, a little bit of fantasy and horror here and there. And they're really knowledgeable, which is good. I mean, I write for Bureau42.com, and I need to get back to posting these videos regularly on Bureau42.com. But for a large chunk of my life, I fell out of sci-fi fandom for various reasons. And as I'm trying to get back in, having these people there talking about how this connects to other writers, and the fact that they're not just talking about new stuff, but older stuff, is something I appreciate. It helps me get kind of in what's going on and gives me ideas for other books to read later and that sort of thing. Beyond just the Golden Age stuff that I reviewed earlier, like with the Cities in Flight, first book of Cities in Flight, as well as stuff other than really new stuff, like The Quantum Thief. This really made me wish that maybe someday, if they ever decide to allow humble critics on the show, I might someday maybe get my chance to be on there and present some other interesting science fiction book that more people should read, or I think people would be interested in, or maybe even a video game or something, or a work of animation. This is what I look for in a podcast. And the only thing that could possibly top it is Starship Sofa. Starship Sofa was nominated last year for Best Fanzine and won. And what it is, essentially, is it is a podcast equivalent to old science fiction magazines like Galaxy Magazine or Analog. We have one, possibly two, short stories per episode, read by a very good narrator. It rotates based on the story. Plus plus interviews with writers and artists in the field, and we have contributed columns about the history of science fiction and other wonderful stuff, and it is glorious. It is an excellent, excellent podcast. And it's the only thing that could possibly top the SS Squeecast for me. And I'd love to see it win again. But SS Squeecast is my runner-up. I believe the awards go in a hierarchical pick thing. So that's how that goes. Now again, this award is only being given out this year, and it'll be up for review to see if it's renewed for another year. And I do hope it is, because there's a whole bunch of other excellent science fiction podcasts that have not been nominated yet. For example, there is the Sword and Laser podcast, hosted by Tom Merritt and Veronica Belmont. And there is the Escape Pod podcast, which is in a similar vein to the Starship Sofa podcast. These also, I think, would be excellent nominees for future awards. And I do hope that when they have the Worldcon Hugo Award board meeting thing when they talk about changes for the awards and what's the column categories are for renewal and that sort of thing at WorldCon this year. I do hope they keep that in mind. I hope that they do bring up Starship Sofa's basically other counterpart in the Skate Pod, as well as Sword and Laser and other podcasts that say, hey, for all the ones that got nominated this year, there's plenty more that could and should be up for future awards in this category. We should give them that shot. And so, with all that done, next week I am taking a look at another science fiction novel that I just finished recently. From last year, it is, as I mentioned before, The Quantum Thief by an author whose name I'm not even going to try to pronounce. Until next time, thanks for watching.